All right, so it's hard to carry all this equipment as well as seed for the birds, but it's going to happen because we're all going to the same place. We're going up here. We're going to work on this pear tree right here, and I'm going to do a mix of handheld and tripod footage so that things will be clear. So let's get started. We've got to put out our daily seed ration for the birds. Hope you guys enjoy. They'll come around. This seems to be a good setup. Speaking of wildlife, it's out here earlier. I put it up on Instagram, but I was checking in the hidey hole here for Mr. and or Mrs. Snake, see if he or she was out, and look at this. There's the tail from one. He's already out. There's at least one there that's already out. And there's at least one there that's already out. So there's three right there. So I need to have a light step as I move around the orchard this morning. Make sure that I don't take out anybody who already lives here along with me. So this is my Keiffer pear tree that we're going to be working with. And it's actually not just Keiffer. It's got two other grafts in it. It's got Southern Bartlett or Good Williams pear or Bon Chrétien. Same thing. And it's also got Alton Broussard grafted in it. And I'll show you those up close. But I just want to give you kind of an establishing shot here. The tree is about, I'd say, between 13 and 15 feet tall. Definitely taller than me. And I think the pruning on this is actually going to be fairly easy. If you look over here, you can see a lot of my other trees over on this side. I keep everything small because that's the height at which I can manage it well and that I can reach. And so that's what I'm going to do with this tree. Let me show you some details. So the most important detail that I can show you right now for starting is this lateral branch and this lateral branch. These are two branches that used to be as vertical as all these others that you see here, and I trained them down last year. I put twine around the end and I staked them to the ground and I trained them down. That is a technique to induce fruiting in a branch. It changes the hormones in the tree from being auxin dominated, which is the competitive hormone that makes the tree want to go up, up, up and be the king of the forest. And if you train those branches sideways, it turns them into a branch that's dominated by the gibberellin hormone, which makes the tree want to settle down and start producing a family, start producing fruit. So it's a way to induce fruiting in your tree. And I've done this to lots of trees here, but I did this last year and the immediate change was that it produced all these fruiting spurs, and we had a ton of pears on this tree last year. Again, this is a Keiffer pear, it's a great pear. So I want to make more branches like this and less branches like all those up there. I don't need all that height. I can't reach that. I may leave some, you know, for the birds and other wildlife. I'm certainly not against that. That's great for them. But I can't really manage it up there. So what I'm going to be looking at today is how to train more branches down like this and cleaning up these branches, right? So I don't need that. I need to cut this back to about here where there's a fruiting spur. I need to make some decisions about these branches, and I'll get the camera set up and kind of walk you folks through this and show you, you know, why I'm making the decisions that I'm making. And real quick, I can show you right here. Here's the Alton Broussard graft. I'm pretty sure this is Alton Broussard, yeah. That I got from a friend, Larry Stevenson, who's in charge of the Southern Fruit Fellowship. It's a great, great group to be part of. But you can see right there, sorry, is the graft, right? It's kind of a saddle shape. I grafted that last, when did I do this? I did this in, was that April 11th, April 4th? Can't quite tell. But yeah, so that wasn't even a year ago. And it went from this stick of scion wood right here. Sorry, I know this is jerky camera. It put out all that growth last year. So what is that, 3 feet? Probably, maybe a little bit more. That's awesome. Meanwhile, when you do different pruning, like I cut off this branch, the tree responds with vigorous growth. So all these fireworks, all these water sprouts that have shot up, like right here, that's the tree. If you make a pruning cut, especially in winter, it stimulates very vigorous growth the following season. So my job today is to come, even though it's winter, it's January, but it's almost 60 today. It's crazy. I still need to do my pruning. And I should have done some summer pruning, but I didn't. So anyhow, now's my time to fix that. Oh, and let me show you the Southern Bartlett graft. The Southern Bartlett graft is even crazier. Well, maybe it's as crazy. It's right here. I don't know if you can make this out, but you can see the saddle cut right there. And then all of this, look at that. That's almost 6 feet of growth came from there. So this one's actually gonna be pretty easy to clean up, and I'll show you that in a minute. All right, let me get the camera set up on the tripod so you can see some of the larger picture here. And then there's Lillian watching over us right now. All right, let's get started. All right, so when you're growing your fruit trees, you gotta think about where is your emphasis. Is your emphasis on the fruit or is it on the tree? And in my context, in a small urban lot in town with a ton of trees, trying to manage them very intensively, my emphasis is on the fruit. So that means keeping this tree small. It means training the branches down for more fruit production. So when I'm in here working, I'm thinking about which branches can I train down to produce fruit and still keep the tree very healthy. And that's my main goal, that's my main objective. So I'm gonna bring the camera in closer now and I'll show you some of the decisions and we'll start cutting. But it's important to think about your context. All right, so we're gonna take this branch right here. This is the branch I trained down last year. It's got a ton of fruiting spurs on it. That's awesome. I probably need to thin them a little bit, but I'm not gonna do that today, but I am gonna go ahead and cut off these. I don't need this. That might turn into a fruiting spur. I'm gonna cut just above a bud. This is perfectly good scion wood that I can graft onto another pear rootstock, so save that. I'm gonna cut this just above that bud. You could graft this. It's too small for me to prefer to work with, so just gonna mulch it. Here at the end, it's gotten a little long. I'm gonna cut back to here. I'm fine with that being the end. And this, I'm gonna encourage this to become a fruiting spur, so I'm gonna cut it back there, mulch the rest of it. So this, and this, I've now got two pieces of scion wood. This long thing here, I could train this out like this. I could train it out like this, but there's actually two larger branches back here that I'm gonna train. So I'm just gonna take this out. This is, you can get, I don't know, 3, 4, maybe 5 pieces of scion wood out of this. If you bud grafted, you could have 20 trees. I'm not that good, so I'm not gonna do that. I'm gonna go ahead and take this off here. That's viable scion wood though. I can graft that. So this branch is cleaned up and I'm gonna move the camera and show you two bigger branches that I gotta think about that are part of this branch. All right, so I've got these two branches here. They vigorous, I mean, look at that. That's all from this last year. That's at least 4 feet of growth, maybe 5 feet. But they're really close, all right? They can't both stay. This one is taller, it's branched off a bit. I would say that it's the more vigorous one. I'm gonna take it off because I'm trying to control this tree for vigor. I'm gonna take it off, and this one that survives, I'm gonna train down to about like that. And I think that's my plan for this. So I'll make those cuts. Probably shouldn't do this with hand pruners, but I did. There's a ton of scion wood right there. You can graft a bunch of perfectly viable Keiffer pear trees out of this, and indeed I will. So I'm gonna go and get my twine so I can train this one down and you guys can see what that looks like. So I'll be right back. All right, so I've got my branch all trained down here. It's tied right here. There's a little bit of fabric around the branch, and then this twine is on top of that so that it doesn't create like a tourniquet, which is too tight, and I wind up killing the branches. Sometimes you have a super vigorous tree and that won't matter. It'll just go around and absorb the tourniquet. I've done that a couple times, unintentionally. The only other thing I'm gonna do is, I think I'm gonna take out this entire branch because this is a walkway through here. There's pretty tight spacing. So there's not really an opportunity for things to grow much out this way. And also when this leaf's out, it'll kind of obscure the sunlight on this side. So I'm gonna go ahead and take this off actually way down here. And then there's scion wood, there's scion wood, there's scion wood, there's scion wood. I mean, I'm probably gonna pull 40 or 50 feet of scion wood off of this one tree when we're all done. The other thing to think about is this is the south-facing side of the tree. So there will be no shortage of adventitious buds to bring out additional branches if the tree feels like it needs it this way. Northern branches are a little harder to grow and you want to be a bit more select or choice when you're moving them, but I'm going to take this whole thing off. I'm going to leave enough of the branch collar for it to heal okay. It's a little ragged, but it'll heal. This is a pretty tough tree. I can even put some of Howard Gardner's, the dirt doctor, Howard Garrett, the dirt doctor's tree goop on that if I want, and protect that a bit. But it should be okay. I'm gonna cut this up for scion wood, and then we'll move on to the next cuts. All right, so I don't need this. This doesn't have anywhere to grow over here and be out of the way, so it's gonna be unhappy here. So I'm gonna go ahead and take it off. Another 2 feet of scion wood. And I know I'm gonna take this off. I'm gonna take this off. And that's another extra foot of scion wood. This is kind of growing into the tree. I mean, I can clear this out and do a couple things, but I don't want this here. I leave a little bit of a stub in case it decides to be a fruiting vine. There's a little thing in here I just pulled out. This, you know, it's kind of high enough. I might leave it. I have a weird plan for this I'll talk about in a minute. So let's deal with this. So I could train one of these. I can't do both, I gotta pick one. Could come over, basically mirror this one, just like I did on that side. It's kind of this fan shape developing. Take this one out. It's the least in line with this main branch stub that's coming off here. So what I mean is the back one is more straight together as this one comes out. So this one's more of a line. So I'm gonna take this off. Where am I? This is the more vigorous one. I could slow the tree down by taking this one off, but this one has so much more growth, and I feel like I have more options. Like, I could take this one over like this. There's a dogwood, a red twig dogwood shrub back here that has been cut to the ground for winter, but it'll come back up to like this height. I've got my zebra grass here, so I need to think about this. I think I'm going to keep this vigorous one and get rid of this one. So yeah, no looking back, it's done. And there's another 2.5-3 feet of scion wood as well. So now I'm gonna go get my stakes and my twine and I'm gonna train that one down. All right, so I've got this tangle here with some fruiting spurs, and right underneath here is a red twig dogwood bush that's supposed to get about this high if I keep it in check, and then I cut it back each year, but it's gonna grow quite a bit this year. So I can't really train any branches down this way. And this is pretty rigid. Its growth on the north side of a tree, which is hardest growth because it receives the least amount of sunlight, but I can still do something with it. I trained this one over here, so I don't want to kind of crowd things, and plus I may pull one of these bigger branches up top down as well. So I could make a cut here and then train this out or let this come out like that. That may be a little close to that. Not really, but you don't want this to get too congested. I know that this cluster right here has got to come off. That's the decision I can make right now. So I'm gonna do it, and when I take it off, I'm taking it off for a couple reasons. One, because that leaves this as an uninterrupted line instead of coming and then branching up like that. and I can probably bend this somewhere that I want because it's still young and flexible. But when I take this off, I get all three of these, which are perfectly fine big pieces of scion wood for grafting and making more Keiffer pear trees. So no brainer on this one for my goals and my context. This up here, I'm not quite sure about, right? Am I working? Do I want to take this branch and try and make something of it? I think that's what I want to do. I'm going to put a tie over here and pull this hard that way. And then some of this might have to go. That's probably going to have to go because the cardoon's going to be there. The grass is going to be there. The red twig dogwood's going to be there. So I'm probably going to go ahead. Oh, I'll let it go another season just to see. But I need to get twine on this, so that'll be the next thing. And then there's a little stump back here that's going to be going back into itself, so go ahead and remove that. Any recursive growth back into the tree, is usually a fine candidate to remove. I think the priority is disease growth, crossing branches, and then pruning for aesthetics or production. So if there's anything dead or diseased, take it out. If they're crossing branches, they've got to not rub up against each other because they'll create, worse than a callus, they'll create a raw spot, which is an inflection point for disease, potential disease vector. And then lastly, you train for, you know, what is the production that you're after. All right, folks, so this is a real easy one I just want to show here real quick. This right here is where I grafted Bartlett onto this tree last year. And I know I want to remove all this other growth from the Keiffer, so that's got to go, that's got to go. This part here has got to go. And then this little part here crossing in front has got to go. So I'm just going to take those off right now. All right, so I took those out, and I said they had to go because I want all the energy that's coming out of this main trunk here to go into my new variety, not any of the original Keiffer. I want it all to invigorate this already pretty darn vigorous. Look at all that. That's all 1 year growth of this Bartlett pear, this Southern Bartlett Bon Chrétien. I'm gonna leave this one because it is part of the Bartlett scion, and it could potentially, when it's bigger, come out over here. But I'm gonna train this one also, but I'm nervous to do it because I don't want to break the graft, right? The graft isn't even a year old. So I may leave this as it is right now, this year. And then when I'm sure that it's really much more vigorous, actually work on bending it down next year. Or what I could even do is cut that right there, which would really force a lot more growth out of this. And then maybe that's how I'll get my lateral branches. I'm just not sure yet what I wanna do. I don't know if it's safe to bend this right at its weakest point. Also, there's no real place for this branch. It's kind of recursive growth, growing back into the tree, even though it's on the north side, and you want to be careful about taking those out. There's the cardoon, there's the grass, there's comfrey. The underside of this tree, the undergrowth, is going to be pretty vigorous, so there's not really a place for this. So I'm going to mulch this. Same reasoning, I'm going to take out this branch as well. I can't really train it over there because it'll be in the way of the cardoon, and it'll get closer to the Fuji apple, so I'm going to take both of these out. And I can do these on camera. All right, so that's done. Cleaning up the bottom of this tree, this is looking good. I'm just gonna probably mulch those branches that came down. I'll find them and chop them up. I'm gonna take this one and train it down to about here. And I think I'm actually gonna cut this one back a lot more than I thought I was. I might take it all the way back to here because I don't really see a viable growth path for this one, but I'm definitely gonna train this one because underneath its canopy, there's room for cardoon, the comfrey, the red twig dogwood, the zebra grass, the other grass. I think it'll be fine. I think what's probably going to get cut is more of this one right here. Yeah. All right, let me go train this down. All right, so I trained this branch down, no problem. This is the dominant, this is the main trunk of the tree. This is the main branch. This little fellow here is always going to be frustrated. I don't really have any other place to take it, so it's coming out. And I figured out what I'm gonna do with my piece of Bartlett, the scion from Bartlett. So the graft is right here. So I don't wanna damage it by doing anything too radical. So I kinda have to creep up here. See if I can do this without showing you guys my belly. There we go. God. Hopefully I didn't just put a bunch of ticks in my pants. So I'm gonna train this over like this, and I'll probably take this branch out entirely because the cardoon's gonna get up here, the Fuji apple tree is already kind of creeping over this way, so I mean maybe there's room to snake a little branch under here. Maybe I'll do that. It is a north side of the tree growing branch, so maybe I'll keep it like this, but this is definitely gonna happen with my branch of Bartlett. So let me do that next. All right, so I've got my Bartlett trained down. I've got this lower branch here trained down. And as I've moved more around the tree, I've made some additional decisions about what I'm gonna cut out. I think I'm gonna take out this entire thing. It's low on the north side, so it's gonna be more growth up here. And I think it's just always gonna be shaded out. You know, I'm trying to create this kind of canopy here where these other plants, these low shrubs can grow up. I just think this is never gonna be happy here. So I'm gonna get my saw, I'm gonna take that out, and that'll be the next step. So I've got a decision to make here, I've already made it. These two branches, well these three branches here, this is my Alton Broussard scion that I grafted on last year. I definitely want to keep it, and I'm going to pull it out that way, kind of over top of this one, but that way a bit. I can't leave both of these. One's got to go. I'm going to take this lower one because it's pretty much in the same line as this one underneath. So it's kind of parallel, it's redundant. I'm going to take it out about here, and then this one, I'm going to bend out this way. So I think that's my next task.
Hey, just a more detailed close-up of what I'm doing here. The Alton Broussard, I'm keeping and I'm going to bend out that way. This one, I'm keeping and I'm going to bend out towards me. This one is going to go because it's redundant to this one. I've already got a branch going like this. That's the path that this one would have, but I've got that covered, so I'm going to take it out. It's also pretty vigorous. Like, even though it's lower down, it's taller than its neighboring branch. So I'm going to take it out and that'll reduce the vigor of the tree a bit. All right, folks, so I trained this higher branch up and over like that. It's down to here. It's in line with some of these others, you can see. And now I'm gonna move over to here. Just keep changing sides. And I'm gonna deal with these two right here. So they can't both stay. I need to cut back some of the growth. And originally, I was gonna take this one because it's the more vigorous one, and it would knock some of the vigor out of the tree. But I'm gonna go over this way with it, and I want the extra length that this one provides. So let me show you. I'm gonna take it over here, kind of like this. It's probably a little harder with the handheld. I should have done this with an establishing shot, but you'll see it in a minute. But I just want you to know why I'm going to cut this one and not this one, okay? And honestly, with that bent over, the top of the tree is getting thinned out quite a bit. So I'm getting close to being done here. All right, folks, I have this one trained down now the way I want. We're getting mighty close to being done. I'm gonna take this little piece off here because this is Keiffer and this is my Alton Broussard scion. And I'm gonna take that off so that all the energy in this branch is going into my Alton Broussard piece. And then I need to bend this Alton Broussard piece down. I'm gonna have to get a step ladder to do that, so I'll just show you the end result rather than recording my potential demise and or embarrassment. So be right back. All right, folks, we are in the home stretch here. Most of the branches that I wanna keep have been trained down to where I want them, including my Bartlett and my Alton Broussard. And really,
all that's left now is the top of the tree. Let me show you. So this tree has a very distinct, right, what it wants to be the trunk, the main one. It's this. For a little while, these two were competing, right? But this one, now that I've bent all of its highest growth over, it's taken out of the competition for sure. It'll put up some shoots next year or this year, but they're not gonna, this branch has decided it's gonna settle down and start producing fruit. These guys are still reaching for the stars. So this one in the back, I'm gonna bend over because it's high enough above all this stuff that it can arch over quite nicely and provide plenty of fruit for me, for passersby, for the birds. The top two that are left, I'm not quite sure about. I could bend that one over. I could cut that and cut that. We're getting close to the power lines. The depth perception may be a little off, but there's only a couple feet between the cable and the top of the tree, and if you don't tend to that after a while, the power company will come and take care of it for you. So I don't want them to top my tree. I want to be responsible for my tree. So I'm going to think about what I want to do with this trident up here, this cluster, but I know the back one I'm going to bend over, so I'm going to go ahead and do that next.
All right, so with the help of my lovely wife, who's now working the camera.
Hi!
We've trained down everything that we want to train down, and all that's left is the, earlier I was saying the main trunk, I kept forgetting to say central leader. That's the term that I wanted to use. That's this right here, and it's just too tall. Like I said, I don't want the power company to come and cut it. I want to make the cuts for my tree, so I'm going to come back with, get on the ladder, and I'm going to take it out right there. We've bent these two down, and we'll take this off, and a new central leader will emerge over the spring and summer, and we'll cut that out, deal with that then. But we're going to take all that out, so I'll show you that in just a sec. The other thing is I want to show you some cool sorcery of what I may do with this last branch here, right? So this is the south-facing side of the tree, and I was thinking I was just going to cut this out because this is a walkway. So if I can do this without showing you on my belly. But it occurred to me that this piece, I'm going to trim up this Arkansas black apple, and I was going to take this whole branch out, but then it occurred to me that I could join them together and we'd kind of have a bit of a fruit bough under which we could walk. I can't remember what I was reading, but I did actually come across this in something I was reading recently, and I wish I could remember what it was, but they talk about doing a fedge or a food hedge, and when the apples and the pears ran together, they would graft them together to form one kind of super organism. So I may do that. I mean, what's the harm? As my wife said, if it works, great, and if we decide we don't like it, if it doesn't work, no biggie. So I'm not gonna do that today, but I think I will do that. So all that's left is for me to take the top out of that tree, and that's what I'm gonna do next.
Okay, I just wanted to share my lovely camera woman. This is my lovely wife, Elise. She's
Hi.
A nurse. She's perfect in every way. Love you. There you go, folks. There's just one more angle here. We're done. We've trained down all the branches. I took the central leader down quite a bit. And I told you I thought I'd get about 50 feet of scion wood. I'm gonna stand by that. Maybe it's not quite that much, but it's quite a bit. It's quite a bit, and in fact, I had to take some off of my Arkansas black apple cultivar while I was working on it. So I got a couple sticks of that. I gotta clean these up and put them in the fridge tonight so that they don't dry out. But you can see where we did this union here between the Keiffer pear and the Arkansas black apple. That'll be cool if they fuse together. If they don't, though, no biggie. But it might be kind of neat to have this arch that we can walk through as we exit our garden. But I'm really pleased with the way the pear tree is cleaned up. And yeah, if you like this sort of thing, check me out on Instagram at Ben Capozzi, or check out our Facebook page for Elmwood Farm Tree Crops. Thanks a lot.